Everybody's back from lunch, I can see. Fascinating, very good. Okay, to explain a bit my role, this is here Daimler Research, my name, then Daimler Research. Daimler is a car company. They make the Mercedes-Benz cars, Maybach cars, trucks, vans, and have services and everything more. It's a global company. And my role then there is in this company, some people say I am the resident philosopher, yeah, or futurist, to bring impulses into the company, partly to create new show cars or new ideas with them. Partly these concepts then are visible for our public, partly they are not. And what you see here in the background, first the title Ethics by Design, I will come to the ethics parts later on. First, this one was the picture here, the image here is a result of a challenge we have done with digital design artists. Digital design artists are the people who make the special effects we love in the sci-fi movies, and we gave them the task to make desirable futures for the year 2050, 2060. To do so is a very good thing to get in contact with avant-garde people, with people who have maybe more imagination than in the industry is, also artists, designers and stuff like that, also people like that. This one was, if you look, the task was to say, okay, what's your inner child in the year 2060, and you know, this inner child of this artist, he always has a plant in his rucksack, yeah, so he can have life on Earth. The images the people showed us were positive in a way, but not completely. Everybody, this one, I like that very much. It was, you can see it, yeah, she needs, it displays the desire for nature, yeah, the cat, but on the other hand, she has to wear this helmet, so she is separated from nature. So you have these positive visions, but also realistically some skepticism in it. This one was another example about an desirable future from in Africa. Yeah, people think, people visualize that in Southern Africa. And what we can do with these pictures, with these images, to discuss them with the engineers, discuss them with the designers. Yeah, so bring this the spirit of the outer world inside the company. Yeah, that's a very important part of my work to do so. And to explain it and to talk about with these people about these visualizations will give us, they will see something else than we are seeing in them. Yeah, they see technologies, for example, technologies maybe they can build, yeah, or they can are motivated to build. So this picture here was a winner of the challenge. You can find it if you are interested. If you looking for artstation.com, the THU challenge, Trojan Horse was a unicorn, was a name, and then you can find these images, and then it's you will see for yourself what's the mind space, what are the ideas of the future of these people, and that's always interesting because you can transform it, translate it into the corporation, yeah, in the society, into different worlds. Here you can see what was very common in all these visualizations was how to integrate nature, plants, animals, how to integrate them with technology, how to make it safe, how to bring us near, yeah, to nature. Very simple in a way, but that's obviously a very strong desire in the end all around the world. Yeah, we made a similar challenge together with Red Bull about desirable futures. It was video clips, and that was in the end the same. That's our people, it's about people, and it's about nature. It's not so much about digital technology anymore. Yeah, so digital technology is seen mostly as a given. Yeah, it is there, like electricity, like lights, for example, but it's not a topic on its own anymore. Yeah, we are working together, for example, with Ars Electronica in Linz, and they have these awards for cyber arts too, and for STARTS. STARTS is the industrial is a project from the European Union for Industry and Artists, yeah? And you can see that since 3 years, I would say, it is very, very clear, the view is very clear that the digital has lost its cool, yeah? And the biology is coming in. Yeah, so the future is more slimy, so to say, yeah, algae everywhere and bacteria, and so on. The digital is only a tool. So you see that here also in these pictures. But back to the ethics. If you talk about ethics and design, we have to talk about what is human, what are we humans, or how would we like to be? Yeah, because ethics is always about people. Yeah, to respect the autonomy of others. It's a key sentence in ethics, and therefore you have to see, okay, what are we? What do we want to be? And to think of that, look at this savanna here. Yeah, this savanna is very important because wherever this savanna was, that was our birthplace as a species. Yeah, and you can say, okay, this is a long time ago, but that's not true. Because if you read that the North American people, yeah, they set their thermostats, their temperature, after the environmental temperatures from Kenya, from the savannah. Yeah, everybody does that, thinking, hey, that's individual. I like it that way, but that's I is not I. Yeah? It's not the person, it's the species. Yeah, so if you are hungry, maybe you have very hungry ancestors. No? If our ancestors loved this atmosphere in Kenya, yeah, like that, and then we think it's our taste or our will, free will, it's not. Yeah, we're acting on a different space, in a different time frame, so we are deep, so to say, yeah, from sitting from time. And to visualize that, I give you this one here. It's about, if you look at the top, yeah, here the smiley on the top, this is you, me, everybody as we are, yeah? Normally we think about us, not we forget that we were babies, we forget that we were going to school, we forget everything we are now. And now we are perfect. Everything was wrong in the past, as babies we were stupid, but now we are perfect, yeah, that's there. And from baby to you to now, this is called the ontogenesis. Ontogenesis, your own development, yourself. Yeah? 10 years later, we will think, in 10 years, we will think again that we are perfect. Yeah, and now we are stupid in looking backwards like that. So we are always perfect there. And we are coming from, that's the iceberg here. We are coming from the history of the species, the phylogenesis. And the phylogenesis then has its foundation in so-called symbiogenesis. Symbiogenesis means when life started to begin, the bacteria, all stuff like that, were coming together. And these phylogenesis is in us. This is, on the one hand, it is our being, yeah, as a person, as interaction, love, hate, hunger, stuff like that. On the other hand, it is culture, yeah, our language. We wouldn't be able to speak without our ancestors, yeah, we wouldn't be able to do anything, yeah, so we are deep in this way, embedded in culture, we are deep embedded into body, into physical stuff, yeah, into an environment, our body too. And today, when we are living here in our life, in the ontogenesis, then we are embedded in culture and in our reality as we are. So our self is not very closed. Yeah, it's a kind of an open system. Yeah, for myself, I would compare myself sometimes with a flame. Yeah, you can see the flame, it's there, but you can't grab it. If you want to replicate it, you will not be able to do so because the flame is always different. Yeah? So, and if we go ahead, if we have this picture of us as we are, then we have to grow, can go a step deeper. What was symbiogenetics? And that's here the some remarks to the planet, another planet. Symbiogenetics means, if you like to read that here, you should go for Lynn Margulis, and the book is Symbiotic Planet. It was a fascinating way to redefine evolution, redefine how life in itself comes into existence. Into existence, it was very roughly in this way that our cells, we have cells. Yeah, and you have seen in school, you have this, every cell is built like a manufacturing plant. Yeah, everything is in a cell, it's perfect in itself. And this inside the cell, this is, if you follow this Lynn Margulis, these are bacterias, living entities, yeah, which in this billion years history of the Earth, they didn't merge, yeah, to be one, but they were combined, yeah, into together to a new being, yeah. So in a cell, in a bubble, then there's one bacteria, then two, then three, and in this bubble, then had more properties than the single bacteria. And that was not a fast process. That took billions of years. And this symbiosis has not stopped ever. So symbiotic, as this coming together from entities which are still there, this is still working in us. Still working means that it's our DNA is exchanged all the time with ancient DNA, so it's not fixed. Yeah. So this is an ongoing process. Ongoing process means another planet would be very dangerous or very impossible, because we are embedded in our environment completely on a microscopical and on the size which you cannot see. So this quote, if you can read that, it is about, she said, you cannot heal our sick planet because it's delusional, because we are part of the planet's atmosphere, and the planet's atmosphere is way stronger than we are. Yeah, it's in the end the Gaia hypothesis. That's one thing. So we are very deeply embedded into the biological world. Yeah, and even more, this one is here. Sabina Spielrein was the first female psychoanalyst, and she analyzed many dreams of her clients. And the dreams of her clients, she found out that the dreams that people were dreaming, we were dreaming thoughts of our ancestors, myths, yeah, mythology. So her explanation was that was our ancestors that were telling about their mythology. They explained that, they talked about that. This is in us. It's a bit weird, yeah, but these are memories, yeah, which are alive in us, and they came to our consciousness within dreams. So we are connected culturally too. Yeah, and if you put that all, if you can read German, try to find the Jahrbuch für psychoanalytische Forschung. Yeah? That's a very strong language, very perfect. So if you put that together, we can see we are chimeras. Yeah, our inner self, our it, yeah, would look like that. Yeah, today our it is very happy because it's not alone anymore. Yeah, in the past it was not alone because it was a small tribe, maybe 100 people. And now today we have our smartphone and we can say, okay, we are never alone, we have friends. Yeah, in the past the it couldn't get lost because it was always in a known area. Today we have our smartphone again and our map and we get never lost. And we have food forever and no predators. So the it is happy. It's a bit dangerous because the it will refuse any change in our behavior. Yeah, but think of that if you pull up your air condition. So to get on to the ethics. So we have to see, we have now a picture of our role as a human being. Yeah, no, we are many in us, and we have a deep history, and our behavior is not so is only partly conscious. So now if we have now these self-driving cars or any robot, yeah, then we have these two sides. On the one side, we have the machine behavior. It's algorithmic and everything. We are in the middle, yeah, with our intellect, passion, empathy. We can feel And the other side, we have biological behavior. Yeah? Biological behavior we can read. Read means if there's a dog lying there or sitting there, I would feel if the dog is angry or sleepy or whatsoever, how the intentions of the animal are. Yeah, maybe I'm wrong, totally wrong, but I have the idea I can feel it. Yeah, so people have therefore difficulties to explain empathy then. Again, empathy now, the current hypothesis is that empathy is a kind of a replay, yeah, of us. Yeah, a mutual replay. Replay means if you look at me that way, I would do the same. Yeah, or do the same with my hand, and then the feeling emerges in me how I would feel when looking so. Yeah, when I have this posture. So that's the mind reading process. So if I have never had the experience, then I would fail. This works in more or less any animals too. So we can have even with insects, we have a direction. It works. It is an explanation why many people are afraid for snakes or spiders, because we cannot replay them. Yeah, it's difficult to replay a snake or a spider because we don't know which direction they are going. So, but we can with animals. We cannot with machines. We cannot replay a machine. Yeah, the machine stays as it is. So it's difficult for us. That's a design task. It's a design task which is solved. So if you look at this one here, typical famous Tokyo crossing, we see people doing this. Yeah, and this is a nearly impossible task. Yeah, impossible task means they don't think, yeah, and they don't bump in each other all the time. Yeah, so it's on automatic. And how does that work? Yeah, this automatic. There are some models like perception action model means it's a functioning would be I perceive or we perceive each other and the action comes immediately without thinking, yeah, and therefore we don't bump in each other. And the key again is empathy. Yeah, how does it work? How we read the intentions of others? It's about this empathy. And again, empathy, how it's working. Or the meaning or the motivation for that is that our brain or perception is totally, what can I say, on its own. Yeah, it's automatically, and it tries to predict behavior. Yeah, a neuroscience guy, he said, he makes a comparison that our perception works like Scotland Yard in the other direction. Yeah, Scotland Yard looks, they're searching hints for the motivation of the murder, maybe, yeah, to reconstruct the deed, yeah, and our brain, our perception works differently, looking for hints everywhere to predict what will happen. That's the same thing. So it's never a complete picture, it's always prediction coming from hints. So this works. If you now introduce robots into such a picture, yeah, then the people will have to think what to do and they will avoid the robot because they cannot read the robot. Yeah. And so what we have done, this is another example to check out what are robots doing and what are we doing as people, and you can compare that with a baby, our cyber baby, and you see that robots behave completely differently than babies, for example. They're not smiling. You see, we are learning on our way, yeah? While going, we are not going straight. We are doing stuff all the time. Robots don't. But we are competitive. You see? It's the winner. And what's interesting too is if you look at these videos or at the situations, after a short while nobody watches the robots anymore. which means it's a dangerous situation because our perception our perception is always checking for life. Yeah, you can have, and it will check in this case the robots are not alive, so they are not interesting. So delete them. Yeah, it's like if you have a window and it's raining. First, you see, okay, the raindrops. After a while, you don't see the raindrops anymore. They are not interesting. Then a fly comes to the will sit on the window. You will see the fly because it's interesting. So your perception is totally active. Yeah? And so if you have robot cars, there are many examples from self-driving cars that the people rear-end them. I would say because they are invisible. Our perception makes, okay, that's not alive, I delete it. Yeah? It has a low ranking. So this one you can do, you can see this one, but you can make, you can give through tech, you can make this one example for agency through technology. You can have these beacons, yeah? They are visible, cheap and visible for people and for robots too. So you can have even your picnic on the road if you wish, yeah? Would be totally normal in Berlin, and the machinery will see that, will sense that, and will know to avoid it. So you have a safe situation on a public area, yeah, with very simple design. Yeah, because if you are, yes, you see, shouldn't enter, and you can explain it to every child. Okay, don't go behind this fence. Yeah, like that. That's a very simple one. And the last one, we tried that to, because of the, again, the empathy, how to design something to make it, well, you make our perception learn what's happening. And there was one idea was, concept was to, or is, to make the sensor area visible. Because then we can learn that. Yeah, perception is not stupid, it will learn. So you can see gestures are helping them to communicate with the thing. But you see the difference to most robots which are designed now today's. These robots don't show what are they sensing, their sensing area. Yeah, they rely on blind trust. Blind trust is always bad, like plastics. And so we designed the first research car, this one, the FO15, after we learned that, what I told. FO15 was this one, was the most important part, is that you could sit vis-a-vis, because, okay, mobility is stressful, and the best thing against stress is to find somebody to talk to, yeah, and therefore you need a place where you want to talk. Yeah, so it was that was a basic idea. And this car then had the ability to communicate to the outside. Communicate to the outside in the sense that it could sense that there's somebody wanting to cross the street, could project the cross road, yeah, the signs, has indicator lamps that it was in automated mode. Yeah, and even here you can see this is a kind of a digital shadow of the person, and the digital shadow was displayed on the back of the car also, so that other, that's maybe a cyclist behind the car could see on the back of the car. Okay, in front of the car is something moving. Yeah, no, maybe a dog, small, something small. So it was very simple for the cyclist or the other driver, from a normal driver of a normal car, to see. Okay, something is in the front of the next car in front of me, so I will be alert. Yeah, very simple thinking. But then a research car in this time. We did even more research then about these, what is empathy and how can we enhance the cars then, enhance the idea that we can learn about, our perception can learn what's the intention is. We even used ponies for that, because ponies, we have my wife, she has three ponies, and she is not so much riding, but she is wandering around with them, yeah, and so they are a kind of a temporary tribe. So they have to understand each other. Yeah, don't walk about, they have to understand each other, manage difficult situations, and you can't speak with ponies, it's meaningless, yeah? And you have, but they have to understand you, and the easy thing is that ponies have the ears, yeah, and the ears are like open sensors, yeah? If you have ever a pony in front of you and you have the ears of the horse, then everything is fine, then you are interesting. If you don't have an ear, then you are not there, yeah? So ponies have their, I don't know if you have ponies, but you will see it here in the movie a bit, what we have done. We had cameras between the ears, and so we could see through the ponies.
Für mich ist Empathie das Einfühlungsvermögen, was man hat in andere Menschen oder in andere Situationen. Es können ja auch Tiere sein. Empathie ist etwas, was wir Menschen tun, gerne tun und automatisch tun. Das hat unser Überleben gesichert letzten Endes, damit man voraussehen kann, was passieren wird, was andere Menschen oder andere Tiere eben tun. SLAP ist die Abkürzung für See Like a Pony. Mit SLAP will ich herausfinden, wie man nonverbale Kommunikation sichtbar machen kann.
So you have the,
Ponys nonverbal. Wenn ich zum Beispiel gestresst bin oder irgendwie ärgerlich, dann habe ich offensichtlich eine andere Körperanspannung. Ich trete anders auf. Das ist das, was die hören und auf mich reagieren. Man merkt es dann, die drehen sich dann weg. Die Ohren verfolgen einen von hinten, versuchen Abstand zu halten. Wir haben auch so einen Ausdruck entwickelt, du hast ein Ohr mittlerweile, weil es eben genau das ist. Ich mache irgendetwas und das Pony folgt mir mit dem Ohr und hat mich sozusagen im Visier. Und das ist, wenn man das betrachtet, dann auch ein schönes Gefühl, weil es passt jemand auf einen auf. Und das würde ich zum Beispiel gerne auf den Charakter beim kooperativen Fahrzeug übertragen. Also dieses, es ist kein Befehlen zwischen Fahrzeug und Mensch, sondern es ist ein Miteinander und es ist auch ein Aufpassen. Das Fahrzeug passt auf uns auf.
Yeah, to make it, I don't know if this translation works.
Vorstellt mit Mensch und
can you make the sound?
Da muss es sowas wie eine Kooperation geben. Es ist ein Miteinander auf der Straße, so wie es heute auch ist. Jetzt haben wir immer den Menschen, der das Fahrzeug auch steuert und lenkt und entscheidet, ja, ich halte oder eben ich fahre weiter. Dann ist es die Maschine. Und die Maschine muss eine Fläche haben, um uns anzeigen zu können, in welcher Richtung sie agieren wird. Inwieweit sie
you can see the ears, wird,
langsamer, schneller anhalten.
And most important then,
Situation, die wir im normalen Alltagsgebrauch
can you stop the sound?
Mit den Fahrzeugen auf der Straße haben.
No. Okay, the most important thing there was also not only to work with the empathy process in itself, but to work with real animals, with living beings. Yeah, because if you make experimentations with machinery, experimentations with abstractions or digital, then you are that one is what is leaving what you are leaving out is a life. Yeah, and we have. I think we have to in engineering and design. We have to make more contact with real life. Yeah, not controllable as Dan Rusgaard said. Yeah, we like to be in control. You cannot be in control of a horse. Yeah, but since you cannot be in control of a horse, you can learn so much about what is happening. Yeah, and how we have to care for each other. Yeah. And so in this caring process, the car then, or the robot, or self-driving car should behave like that. Yeah, it's a caring thing, artifact. And the learnings were therefore this empathy. You can enhance empathy through technology, like the cameras. That was much better then. Yeah, to feel that you could feel the horse much better. You change your own activities when you see through the eyes of somebody else. Yeah, so we have to think of that too, that we know what does a car see or what not. And it's very good against anxiety. Yeah, and in the end, it's much more fun because we people, as we are, yeah, we have a desire for life, for living things. Yeah. and if you put it all together as regarding mobility, and now we are nearly at the ethics part, But I think it was very much ethics is alone, work with animals and work with life. Yeah, mobility in itself is a cooperative activity based on mutual empathy. It's kind of definition. Cooperative means you cannot see, you have to design the car, the self-driving car or the robot, as it is one actor, yeah, and the other actors, human beings, the other actors are more important than the robot, than the machinery, and the other actors should feel the thing, yeah, they are the actors. If you like theory, then you will find the term cooperative motility from Lynn Loughlin. She's a social scientist, and she has made her research about the rhythm of the cities, for example. Yeah, mobility is kind of a rhythmic activity, and you feel that if you feel it in yourself, if you maybe change to maybe in the southern US, yeah, where everything is kind of like in slow motion, and then you switch to Manhattan, and then it's fast forward, yeah, and then you have a different rhythm. You have to learn the rhythm, yeah, that sort of thing. Shared intentionality from Michael Tomasello means that we love to. He's an anthropologist, yeah, and he researched that with animals and children which in age-wise had not developed true language, yeah. So, and what he said was fascinating was to see that even children that small, they try to help each other out, yeah. And that these help each other, we would see that if here something will happen, an earthquake or something, we would try to solve the situation together without explanation. Yeah, we would do that. Yeah, we don't need a contract, no money, no nothing. We would do that. Yeah, that's shared intentionality. Social brain means that if we are discussing, maybe a group six, seven people that we can describe what is happening, that a kind of a temporary brain would be there, and we can solve problems together. And when we leave the group, then the social brain is gone, yeah, like that. And perception in action model, I explained that again. Explained that our perception works in a way very actively. We perceive and we act, and the narrative why we act, then we invent that later on. Yeah, so neuroscience scientists, they often say we are inventors of ourselves. Yeah, because we invent the reasoning which was not there when we have done the deed. Mind reading is the same thing. Eric Kandel, you would love that. The Age of Insight. Yeah, he is somebody, you know, surely you know somebody who, a neuroscientist who works very much on art. Yeah, how do we perceive art? 2D paintings, and simplified physics work. He called it simplified physics, what our brain is working with. Yeah, that's not the physics we see. It's a bit, little bit, you have to read that if you are interested, Eric Kandel. and from a design decision, the first thing I think we should do always, or what I said is to define what's not to automate. Yeah, because most often people start with the most fun part, maybe design a fashion item and say, okay, I automate the design process. Yeah, machine learning, I did that. Yeah, or the composing. Yeah, you should always think what you want to automate and what not. To automate is everything about data complexity and repetition and parametrized system, closed systems. Yeah, because closed systems, machine learning works best in closed systems, not in open systems. An open system is in the end awful. So I have this slide. Once at the NASA, I presented this one at the NASA in Transitioning to Autonomy was a conference, and they said, it was the first time that somebody wrote down not to automate, because they always wanted to automate the whole chain. Yeah. So, but you can do that on your own and try out what are your own personal talents. You should put that on a not to automate side, and what do you hate? And what is boring, put that on the to automate side and start programming. And now the ethics in the end. Ethics, as I said in the front, is the basic respect the autonomy of other. We should do that mutual wise. And this you can, in a way, this is a perfect design task to do that. Because if you want to respect the autonomy of others, then you need to give them agency. Yeah? If the others don't have agency, then it's not respectful. Yeah? If you are in a prison, you can't do anything, then that's not ethical. Hmm? Because you can't do anything. Yeah? You can only think. That's one thing. Therefore, you need, as a design task, participative innovation, because you need find as many perspectives on the task at hand as possible. Yeah, many people do things for very different reasons. Next thing is you have agency. You have to provide some understanding. Yeah, that the people can understand it. You have to provide information, and most important then, you have to provide handles that they can do something. And if you follow these design tasks, then you have to see that understanding doesn't mean there's a manual provided. It means you have to understand what the people are doing, how the people see that there is a button, yeah, and that's a red button, and that's an off button or something like that. You have to understand everything. You have to understand that not everybody has two hands free to look at the phone all the time, for example, and use an app. That's not the thing. Yeah? Many people are very different. So you have to understand that and give them handles. And if you look at this on a different way, what's to do, we have, in the case of the self-driving car, we have here this closed world. Yeah, the closed world in the middle means this is perfectly to automate. All the parameters are there. Yeah, you can accelerate, use the brake and everything. Yes, it's a closed world. Yeah, but the vehicle in itself is an open world. So you have to, the open world is this cooperative task, all the actors, all the other participants. So what you have to do, you have to create, design a membrane, yeah, around this closed world, so that the other actors can interact with the digital, but it's kind of mechanical in the end, digital system there. Yeah, and we call that what we try to achieve is informed trust, so that the people are informed what the thing is, what's the intention is of the self-driving car. I feel here's an example in what we did for the last experimental safety vehicle. It's about the eye contact. You can play it without sound because it's German language speaking. Without sound.
Straßenverkehr. Diese Beziehungsebene fehlt bei automatisiert fahrenden Fahrzeugen. Das
ESF. Thanks. He's explaining that we make eye contact to make sure. This one is an experimental safety vehicle. It's a little bit overpimped, maybe. It shows with these lights that it has seen you. Yeah, lights on the top has seen you and makes eye contact, so to say. Yeah, eye contact works then. That you see that the LED lamps are following you, yeah, and it displays in the back of the car that in the front of the car someone is. You see that here is somebody crossing the street, yeah, like that. You see that, so that the other one is hopefully alert enough to use the brakes, and that's. That's the beginning. Yeah, we are experimenting with that, with all these signals more. We have even that was a sensational breakthrough. We have the SAE engineering in US. They are the precursor of any legal development, yeah, there, and we have there, they have written, we are allowed, every automaker is allowed now to use these turquoise light to mark the car as in automated mode, and the most important, in the front and in the back. It was very difficult to do that. We have to send a car to Detroit for that, and we have to. It was a hard job because in the US there is nobody coming from the back, obviously, so you need only lamps in the front of the car. So like that. So this is the first step, and the next steps will be that the car will show, okay, it's accelerating, decelerating, And the eye contact, we have many different, we are experimenting with very different methods for that. We call it the cooperative car strategy. Yeah, we have these, this started as I showed you the FO15 as an active communicator. We had made a vision van, more information. The vision urbanetic here, that's a very large thing, a bus, has a nice feature for the I have seen you. It was a kind of a virtual shadow. Yeah, once you pass the car, you would see the LEDs making your following you. Yeah, so you have a kind of a shadow. That was very natural, because if you don't have a shadow, yeah, then you're either a vampire or something is wrong. And therefore the people you will alert you. Yeah, it's very simple. We're always looking for design solutions which are very simple, intuitive, and will alert the people if something goes wrong. Yeah, you have always to think about. You have sometimes in 10 years, or not in 10 years, in 5 years maybe, you have to explain that to school children. Yeah, what's with the bus maybe? Is it automated or not? Yeah, and therefore the bus should be display, I'm in automated mode. And you have to teach the school children then, okay, has it what's to do? If it's automated, has it seen you? If not, go away. Yeah, agency. Ethical is always about agency. So, and therefore the design must be there. That's a design task, all in all. So that was that. And from the import, yes, one thing maybe, the three steps for these, what we are doing about empathy and insight. Most important, the empathy stuff, that you can feel the car. Yeah, what I have explained. But we need some learning processes too. Yeah, like the car, the color is then turquoise, and you should be aware of that. And lessons about if something breaks down, it should break down in the same way all the time. It's again this car, but I think you have seen that now. And that's the last slide, a little bit food for thought about insight and innovation. I would say true innovation is based on empathy. You have to feel the light, you have to be positive to life. It's a kind of erotic desire in the end. Yeah, you have to. If you don't like to touch the world or like to be touched, then it will be not good. Yeah, you need contact. Yeah, otherwise, if you design a table and you don't want to touch that table, then it's a bad table. Yeah, bad design for the table. It's very simple in everything. And innovation in itself is cooperative activity. This is in a way simple, but in the end it's not simple, because today we have so many talents. We need so many talents to make something happen and something work, that we need to that we cannot use these step-by-step innovation process anymore, like here's research and then is development and then product and stuff like that, but we have to seed ideas, yeah, and seed understanding, and then wait a time, like gardening. It's more like gardening. Yeah, you can have a picture of the garden, but the plants have to grow on their own. And the most important part, be Mensch, trust in life. I think if we trust too much in technology, then we will fail. Yeah, we will have to see everything is alive. Yeah. And we are part of it, and we have to be trustful and respectful of that. And with this, I wait for questions. Thanks.